And it's a riot, you know. I wouldn't miss this for an opportunity, you know. You have everybody from little children to older, you know, people, and everybody's just having a good time, you know.
Instant dancer?
Yes, kind of. I rented the tap shoes for the afternoon.
We'll be watching you. See if you get it right.
Oh, thank you.
We're here with Beth Obermeyer, who is a tap dance expert. And we're here to talk today with Beth about tap dancing. Beth is a musician, a dancer, a journalist, and an author of books, including ones about an event that she produced that was the largest tap dance ever in the world that is in the book of Guinness Book of World Records. So welcome, Beth, and thank you so much for being here. As a fan of dance and a lover of dance, I'm so excited to talk with you about tap dancing in particular, because I think it really is a unique niche of dancing. And I'm wondering if you can just maybe tell us a little bit more about what is special about tap dancing.
Well, you are dancing and you're a musical instrument. So the body can be any style of dance you want it to be or that you know how to do. And then the feet are as complicated as you want to make them, just depending on how you feel while you're doing it. So it's a double. And because of that, every tap dancer is different. I think they're like flowers. You know, one isn't prettier or nicer than the other. They're just very different. And especially today, we're seeing a lot of kinds of tap, including going back to the roots of tap dancing in America, the African American and Irish, both. They merged. They were living in the same areas. And their favorite place, they say, would be in a doorway because they had those wooden right up there, and they would tap to hang onto the doorway and do them. So that's the interesting thing about tap dancing is you
and
can do all
was,
that.
When was that tap dancing got started?
Early in America, when the Irish immigrants were mixed with the African Americans who in slavery were dancing already and doing that kind of dance. And then when all the other dance styles merged into it, you really had something. And then one of my favorites was Eleanor Powell, who was in the 30s and the 40s. And I did an enormous tap event in Minneapolis and started corresponding with her. So I have maybe a stack this big of letters from her and photos. And she was just a wonderful person. She did the spins a woman could do and the sounds. She was a perfectionist. She was also an acrobat, which you can see in her flexibility. Mm-hmm. So she's my favorite.
Tap dancers are kind of a certain breed, or are there certain characteristics that
well, they're
make a good
breed
tap dancer?
As soon as they get hooked on it. You know, I used to teach at the Minnesota Dance Theater in the 80s, and I taught all adults, and you could just, well, they already showed up because they liked the idea, but you could just see when it started to sink in, when they heard themselves making the sounds, and they've got a mirror to watch, and oh my gosh, that's me. You just could see them take off. Mm-hmm. No, not a certain breed. I would have truck drivers and house cleaners and CEOs and families, mothers, working people. Everyone took a tap class together. There was no reason except they thought mm-hmm. they would want to do it.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems like you have to like rhythm mm-hmm. anyway. Mm-hmm. That would be my guess.
Some I didn't think really had ever thought about it before, to tell you the truth, but they would pick up on it then, uh-huh. and some would just work harder and do it. It's amazing to watch them develop.
Mm-hmm. Now, you started tap dancing at a very young age.
Just a regular age, 5. That's a good time.
Okay.
And I still remember my mother walking up the sidewalk, and she said, "Would you like to take tap dancing?" And I just thought, my life had just started. That was it. I really wanted to do that. Mm-hmm. So it was just planted, and I just love to tap dance. I love dance in general. I love watching it, doing it.
Mm-hmm. What other types of dance do you do?
Well, you take all kinds, as you do, but what got me really into tap was, well, I grew up doing it, of course, but then when I called the Minnesota Dance Theater and decided I want to teach, tap was something I could do, because by then I was about 30 years old. And so if you're going to start, let's do that one. But I still dance today. I mean, you tap dance forever, and I was able to do a lot of wonderful things after that with the, you know, through the dance theater. I did the Morton Gould's Tap Concerto, which is a 20-minute piece in four movements. And because they were connected to the orchestra and the Nutcracker and the violinist lived on my corner, and you know, you just kind of find your way in. And they gave me the score, and the drummer's part is written across, and you get those rhythms down, and then you turn that into the sound, and then you put the dance over it. And it took me about a year of noon hours between my 11 o'clock and my 1 o'clock class and to put it together. And then it was only one rehearsal, because they're pros. That's how fast they're all ready. But so was I ready, mm-hmm. but it was one rehearsal.
Wow. And this is with the Minnesota Orchestra. Right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Henry Charles Smith conducting. And then Christopher Plummer was coming to be in their British series. Now I'd already done the Tap Concerto with them. And the boyfriend was part of that evening. And so I had the solo in the boyfriend. And then Christopher Plummer, there he was. I was ready to go on, and Sir Neville Mariner's conducting. And I'm concentrating because the music kind of repeats itself and overlaps, and I thought, I've got to get this right. Mm-hmm. Just at the count where he said, all right, we'll take a break, I turned around and Christopher Plummer was right there. I mean, it catches you by surprise. Mm-hmm. I just saw him in his whole Sound of Music outfit, and even though that's not what he had on, but and he was wonderful. We went out to dinner that night, his wife and my husband, and Sir Neville Mariner and his wife, and we were across the street in a restaurant, and it got to be about 2 a.m, this is after the show, mm-hmm. and he lit a napkin it wasn't a napkin, it was that paper that's over a dessert, it floated up to the ceiling, and then we all got to try it. And I'm sure if it wasn't Christopher Plummer, we wouldn't have been able to light our papers. Right. But that memory is so fun.
Celebrity brings certain privileges, I guess.
We want to hear the best one. I don't know if it's the best, but no. Garrison Keillor. I'm going to be on Prairie Home Companion, and I go to the rehearsal, and Butch Thompson sitting there, who would just be a god to me to dance with. Mm-hmm. He said, what do you want him to play? And what my answer was, I'll dance to anything Butch Thompson plays. So he started playing Blue Skies. That was it. The night of the performance, Garrison says, we're going to play Stump the Taps, because I think we can. He said, I want Butch Thompson and the tap dancer to just do this. And he had him play Claire de Lune, Amazing Grace, the Minnesota Rouser, and I've forgotten the fourth one, but right on the spot. But it was radio. Yeah, but you can tap dance to any of those things. I just, for the moment, it was not a hymn, that's all. Amazing Grace is a nice waltz, and then I just kind of, but that was very, and then we did a mood shoe skit where it was supposed to be retractable taps on the shoes, and when the man put his taps out, then I did my part.
Oh.
And then I got to do my Blue Skies solo with Butch Thompson, who, that's a piano player.
Wow, yes, he's wonderful.
Was that three? Christopher Plummer, Garrison Keillor, Gregory Hines.
Oh, okay.
He came to promote his movie Tap, and he had strap-on taps that he gave the audience, and he had me with two other tap dancers pick 10 soloists, and he judged them, and then he had the crowd put on the taps, and then I taught them a dance. And in City Center, we had the three levels going up. That was fun.
That must have sounded awesome, just in a space like that, too.
Yeah, because they laughed so hard. I don't know for sure what it sounded like, but they were, you know, pretty much going up and down at the same time. It was really, really fun.
Yeah. And so you also produced the world's largest tap dance. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
That was 1979, and it's before the internet. So I guess that was the first flash mob, because it was broke. There was a Guinness record of 528. And I guess went into overkill on it, because I thought everybody would want to do it. It's to open the Hennepin Center for the Arts. And we wanted everyone to take part, because there's already a wine and cheese reception and a tour of the building and some galas. But I saw everyone would tap dance on Hennepin Avenue. Well, I was right. Everyone did want to. But I based it on dance schools, mm-hmm. because I knew that they already knew how to pull their students together. But that's a big city street, and so they started teaching the parents and the families the dance, and then they'd get off the bus holding hands, and just to be sure they're safe, which they were perfectly safe. there was a cartoon the next morning that said in the Star Tribune, the coroner said he was tap danced to death, because really nothing was going to happen to them. So they came out of the basement of St. Thomas the Apostle Church and called themselves the Tommy Tappers in their husband's old World War II sailor. Mm-hmm. They were seniors. There were people, I said you had to have tap shoes, and then I just didn't want any tears over the event. They were all reserved in places by that night, but they came with some of them tin foil wrapped on their shoes. Oh. They had thumbtacks stuck into their flip-flops. They had every imaginable way. There were some designer boots with taps put on them, and I'm sure they leaked all winter. But they had to learn the dance, too. And so we ended up with 1,801. Wow. That broke the record about four times over. Mm. And after that, Macy's tried it for 3 years in New York. And the third year, they did break our record. And they break it every year now. Oh. But it took some doing.
Yeah.
But it went so fast that on Friday night, I was so happy that the weekend was coming. It was going to be Monday night, because in my little mailbox was, Beth, is 300 too many? And this is Sue Mattson at a big dance school in Coon Rapids. And no, it's not too many, but many do it. I had to put tap dancers on top of trucks, because you couldn't hear the Minneapolis police band anymore the front rows. We're outdoors. Sound's not going to travel very well. So I put, and you couldn't do that today. A sign of release, I know I'm tapping on top of a truck.
Right, right.
And the bread and beer vendors pulled up their trucks and parked them, and they got on top. And there's a photo of the tap dance. And it was bizarre. She could hear the music, and then every tap dancer for blocks, you know, could see the tap dancers on top. You just had to keep figuring out, because it grew.
That's incredible. I can barely imagine.
It was really fun.
Yeah.
We did it, the routine, 7 times. And the best overview is from the helicopter, because you can see the wave go. But they're doing the same thing. They're doing the step, then they're going sideways, and their arms are all up. Mm. Then they're bending over, doing trench, then they're doing their buffaloes off the side. You can see something's going on the same, because it changed. Oh, I'll never forget that.
Yeah,
night.
Well, I'm sure no one who took part in it would ever forget that.
No, they all signed it, and then when the book came out, I wanted every name to be in the book, and their addresses were on it. So I sat and cut their addresses off of every page of signatures, and just decided I'm going to do 100 a night, you know. And I just sat and watched TV and pasted them on. And I got them there. And then the last group were ones that just signed up that day, and that got to be really helter-skelter. But they find their name in the book. It's there.
Yeah. Wow.
Oh, it's fun.
It's just mind-boggling to see that many names on these.
Did you live in the Twin Cities at the time?
No, I didn't. I didn't.
After that.
Yeah, I wish I had seen that. That would have been really.
There's a YouTube.
Oh, there is.
Yes.
Okay.
I think it's the first largest or biggest tap dance, flash dance. If any of those words is going to bring it up.
Okay.
KSTP did it. It was from their outtakes, and then they gave me permission to put it on YouTube, but not until 2 years ago.
Oh.
But still.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so we'll have to all check that out. That sounds
fun.
Great.
It's fun.
Yeah. Can you do a little tap dancing for us?
I think right here.
It would be kind of neat to hear.
A cramp roll is toe, toe, heel, heel. And you can put a brush on it. There's a riff that's 1, 2, 3 sounds. You can do it walking, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then the other foot, just walk down the street. And you can do it on a stair, going up. I love this step. It goes hop, triple, step, hit, hop, step, hit. Hop, triple, step, hit, hop, step, hit. You're stepping up. Hop, triple, step, hit, hop, step, hit, hop, step, hit, step. You can come down the same way. Hop, triple, step, dig, dig. And when you do it, it's beauty of it is you're checking each step before and after so you don't feel like you're going to fall. You go hop, shuffle, step, hit it, hop, step, now you're on it, now your back foot touches it. So you've got a hit and you've got a touch. And coming down, you touch the edge, step down, and then you're down. And touch it, and then come down. So that's the coolest. And then when Gregory Hines was here, he and I did a step where he connected the toe taps on the inner edge. If your toe tap is on there, that's a toe tap. And if you can get that lined up so that you can hit it, then you can do steps where that's a sound. And it's really fun. That's a cramp roll. And you hit them in the air. Or if they're on the floor, that's a no-brainer. You go, it'll hit. So that's fun. And then there's heel work. You're moving the heels in. And the way I learned to do this, I didn't know it was a skill. When I was about 11, I decided I wanted to play the piano and tap dance. So I played 5'2" and I tap danced at the same time. So as a result, I learned to do my little time step with my piano.
You're tap dancing underneath the piano, so like another rhythm section for
So it is a skill, but it uses really neat muscles. For exercise, because you're using your inner top leg and your core is working because you have to sit up very straight to do it. And I like to do it if people are in a situation where they can't get up out of their chair, then we do challenges. I do challenges with them, and you can use your keys or nickels on a arm. A lot of ways to get the rhythm going.
Do you know if this is done at all, like in senior centers or anything like that?
It should be. I know that there's a thing called music therapy, and you can major in that. And they go to homes and use music, but I don't know why we couldn't have tap dance therapy. Especially because the older you get, the more you're likely to remember the musicals that had tap dancing in them. So it's just kind of like dropping out of the world for a while. And I do like to do it, but I just do it at the end of any reading that I do for my book, because getting people up out of the chair is sometimes hard, but I can get them to do this with me. So
So I hope everybody will try this at home as well. Get tapping.
One I didn't talk about was the Minneapolis. That was the logo for Minneapolis. And I also had a PR company that went with my event company. It was for event publicity. So I suggested to Josh Levinson, who's had the Minneapolis, that the Minneapolis could tap dance. It was a good idea, except I went away for a month, and when I came back, the Minneapolis were made, and I didn't know who was going to do it. Obviously, it was going to be me. So I got my daughter, who was 9, to do it with me. And we did it in a parade. And when we were finished, I thought, there's a Guinness record for distance. And it isn't as far as we did the Minneapolis Aquatennial Parade. So I just sent the photos in. It was all in videotape. And we broke that Guinness record for distance, which was really fun. And we had about 12 tap dancers from the Minnesota Dance Theater with us.
So you were tap dancing down the...
But it was it was 90 degrees and 90 humidity.
Oh, my.
And so Ripley's, believe it or not, made a cartoon out of it, because it was kind of unusual to tap that far, and it was very hot.
Wow.
And the Aquatennial people would pull a tap dancer once in a while because they really want to set the record. But we did go the distance, Kristen and I, and some more. There were maybe about 8 more that did.
Wow.
But it was hot. I never had a bucket of water feel so good over my head.
That was your reward at the end.
Yes, we were pretty overheated. But we didn't know it was going to be that hot.
So
that. Oh, and another one is the tapping nutcracker.
Okay.
I was at the dance theater, and the tap dancers were very busy at that time of year, and they said, why don't we put the tap dancers in the Nutcracker costumes and do a benefit? Mm-hmm. So this was Edward Holmberg, who had who was at Schlamp's with some music, women's clothing. So he did a style show, and I got the costumes to try on the people, and 2 weeks later, we were doing it, but it was simplified a little because all we had was the runway. Oh. They sold so many tickets that they took the stage on one end away from me, and that was a lifesaver.
Uh-huh.
But it was really cool. We did a soldier dance without music, and I did the tapping Nutcracker, and then my daughter was a mouse with two other little girls, so it was really fun to be in the Nutcracker costumes.
Yeah, that would be so unique.
Mm-hmm. For tap dancers.
Yeah, right. For the dancers and the audience.
Yeah, that was fun.
Yeah, so that's such a classic.
And then I got to tap in the Governor's Solarium after that, because they were doing a tour of the Albert Cui's home and Governor Albert. So there I was. And the floor was marble, and it's slippery, so I put my yellow powdered rosin all over it, so they trapped me in there. They said, don't leave because you're going to track, and nobody go in there, just leave until she's done, and then the room was closed off. But tap dancing at the Governor's Solarium.
Yeah, the possibilities are endless where you could tap.
I guess.
Yeah, earlier when you said runway for the Nutcracker, it made me wonder if there's ever been any tap dancing fashion shows or things like that.
I wonder, a tap dancing. They are choreographed.
Uh-huh.
What is that? There's a big one in Minneapolis that I think Myron Johnson choreographed them for years. That's an interesting, but tap, I have to think about it.
Yeah. Well, and too, maybe part of the reason I thought of it too was in the book, the memoir that you wrote about dancing and growing up in Mason City, Iowa, you talk a lot about the costumes that you wore and all of that. So it seems like, part of tap dancing and that performance is, and the costumes all kind of have a feeling, together.
Yeah. My mother saw all the 30s musicals, and she was working in her brother's theater when my dad was in medical school and it was the Depression. And so she came out of that loving the dance and the costumes, and she just had a lot of talent. Mm. So I did get some beautiful costumes from her.
And so this memoir that you wrote, I would highly recommend that people check it out. To learn more about that time and what it was like to be a young dancer and
pre-television
exactly, participating in all these competitions and performances.
Well, there was something going on. They served up live entertainment like dessert in those towns, because there just was live entertainment with everything, because there wasn't any television.
Yeah.
So the opportunities to stunt night in the park and farmers roundup, a lot of things that we were able to, and I wasn't alone. There were a lot of us, and there were whistlers and accordionists and just a lot going on.
Do you feel like we've kind of lost something in all of that, since it's so easy to just turn on entertainment anywhere, anytime now? Or
I think that it has its advantages. We're growing in ways that we didn't grow. We're aware of so much more. As far as doing it yourself, though, they might be a little behind where we were, because we were all there was, so we got to get out and do it. All the time. It's like I was dancing a lot, because we would then tailor the dance to whatever the program was. Like, here comes the bride if it was a bridal shower, and we were just thinking all the time. A jump rope tap if it was for the parks, and okay, we could do a jump rope tap. And my mother would make the costume, and then she'd wind the jump rope with rainbow colored ribbon and put glitter on the baton. It had to learn to twirl a baton. We had to do a baton tap. It was, they'd build drums for us. There was one that had 9 drums. And boys tap danced, a lot of boys. I've got a photo with 9 boys behind four girls. So it was, and then they turned out to be good basketball players later too. But the girls didn't have the sports then at the time, though. We had gym, but we kind of hated it. There wasn't really anything for us. But now, I'm reading about the girls that are up for Aquatennial Queen. Every single girl seems to be in two sports and lettered in them, and I'm thinking, well, that's pretty nice.
Yeah.
So, and I don't know what the answer is. Six of one, half a dozen of the other.
Yeah. Well, it certainly is inspiring to think of all that creativity that just kind of went into the community, and, you know, it was a real way for young people to participate
that
and contribute.
That was a music town, though. Mason City, Iowa had the Music Man. I mean, they own it. It's a music town, and music was everywhere. But there were a lot of little towns around us, too, that were doing the same thing. But oh, my goodness, we had Meredith Wilson. And I had the same accompanist as he did.
Yeah, and so Meredith Wilson is
the composer of the Music Man. He did the book, the lyrics, the music. Mm-hmm. He didn't quit until he got it exactly as he wanted it, and that was really someone to watch. Because we did have the same accompanist, and he would send everything to her that he was doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it had been a long time since I'd seen the Music Man, and I think I'd just seen clips on TV, and so it wasn't real fresh in my mind. But before I came into this interview with you, I kind of refreshed my memory about the songs that were in it, and I couldn't believe how many classic songs there are in that musical. It's really, I don't know if there's anyone who hasn't heard them in one way or another. And
they just had their 50th anniversary in Mason City, and they did a sing-along the weekend before. Huh. I thought that was such a good idea, because not just that town, everybody knows, you know, Shapoopy and...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, or even, like, if people haven't heard songs from the musical itself, I never put it together before that the Beatles recording of Till There Was You is actually a song from that musical too. Well, I am so excited to have heard and had a chance to hear some of your stories and experience related to TAP, and I'm just wondering if there's any wishes that you have for people out there who might have an interest in TAP or kind of want to get back into it or explore that.
Oh, go take a TAP class. They're really in community education everywhere, and a lot of dance schools will teach adult classes too. There are dad's classes now. Just look it up. I know the University of Minnesota has a dance department, and Ellen Keene has her own TAP company. That's Keene Sense of Rhythm, and she's a wonderful tap dancer, and you can take that. But community education, you've got schools with hallways. Yeah. They won't let you on the gym floor.
Oh, okay.
I taught it in a hallway once for a year, and the problem was it was a wood floor, and the janitor, he didn't really want to see that. And besides that, there were 100 wrestlers on the other end of the hallway, and we had the drinking fountain behind us.
Oh, no.
So we finally coordinated with them and said, you know, we have a break between them. Then they could get their drink, and we had yoga right above us.
Oh, my.
But, you know, those are wonderful memories, because we just worked those things out. But the sound of tap in a school,
sorry to
hard services,
it. Yeah,
was very, but the people that came to it were very interesting people. They were neighborhood people in Kenwood, and I got to know them and known them my whole life now. Mm. You'll meet all kinds of people in a TAP class that are fun people.
Mm.
It's like a party.
It seems like you just couldn't do that kind of dancing without having fun with it.
Oh, no. So, you hear that sound and you're making it. And you're making it almost from the start.
Yeah.
You are making it from the start. First night you're there. So.
Yeah. Well, I want to thank you so much, Beth, for sharing all your knowledge and experience with us.
Well, it's an honor to be interviewed by a dancer.